Sean, 50 years on now, how would you look back to that time as a player?
As a player? Well, I enjoyed every game. It was a dream of mine, you know, to play for Celtic. And when I went there, I found that I enjoyed every moment of it. And sometimes you dream something and you never fulfil it. And it's not as good as you thought it was going to be. But everything that happened at Celtic Park for me was great, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year. And I would do it all over again. I'd never change anything.
Hello and welcome to the Lost Boys Podcast. My name is Chris McGuigan and you're listening to podcast number 154 on February the 16th, 2013. We're absolutely delighted to have Stephen Sullivan on this week. Stephen worked for the Celtic View for many years and then moved to UEFA.com. But at the minute he's working on the biography of Sean Fallon, and the book will be out later on in the summer. And there's an RTE documentary next Friday, the 22nd of February, about Sean. So have a good in-depth chat about the life of Sean Fallon. And when you hear some of the stories that Stephen tells, you just realise that this man was part of the history of Celtic. And when you look back to some of the events that he was involved in, either as a player or as a manager, it brings it all home. Just how important he was. And Sean Fallon always struck me as being such a private man and was always kind of in the background, but his story is absolutely fascinating, and this is one that you should really listen to. Here we go, hope you enjoy it. So here we are. I am absolutely delighted to say that on the line I have Stephen Sullivan. How are you, Stephen? Are you with me tonight?
Yeah, doing very well, Chris. Obviously disappointed the result last night, but it's not doing very well. Thanks, yourself.
Oh, thanks. I'd sort of forgotten about that. I was looking forward to having an interview with you, and I'll be thinking about it all day. Thanks for bringing the pain back, Stephen. Good job.
No.
Good work, man. This is off to a flyer, isn't it?
I know, one of these things. I know it's just been a bit of a sore day, hasn't it? But I actually played well, didn't they? I mean, first half especially were terrific, but people just see the result, don't they? That's the problem, and you know that around Europe, people who didn't watch their game live, they'll just see the result and think, oh, could that Celtic find their level, and don't really think it was that way at all.
It was all very disappointing. I think we all got a wee bit carried away with the emotion of the whole occasion, and maybe it realigned us a little bit, let's put it like that. Our aspirations may be a little bit different after that.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of these things, as I say, we actually played, certainly first half, played better and had more of the game than I expected us to, and yet you come away with a result like that. It's hard to take, but the only thing you could say is that a few, you know, seeing as Aguirre back to his form from a couple of seasons back, and a few of our boys that played better than I even expected them to, and I still think there's reason to be cheerful.
Okay, I'll take your word for that. There's plenty of things to be cheerful about. Of course there is. So we'll maybe talk a wee bit about the match from last night later on in the podcast. I just want to introduce Stephen to everybody. Stephen is currently the editor for FIFA.com and is also working on a book about Sean Fallon. Stephen, tell us a wee bit about yourself and how you actually got involved in writing the biography of Mr. Fallon.
Yeah, no problem. I mean, before I worked for FIFA, I was with Celtic for 7 years, from about 1999 to 2006. I left just before the 2006 World Cup. And I interviewed Sean several times during that, and I always just found him to be just a terrific guy and, you know, everything everyone expects, like a great Celt, very humble man. And he was someone I'd really been interested in. I remember having the centenary year video. You might remember that yourself, the Kamako Vani one. And I just loved that. You know, I was young at the time and just watched it over and over again. And Sean was quite prominent. And I remember just thinking, you know, because he was talking about how he hadn't got the job. He'd been kind of basically lined up for the job before Jogsen came, and how he knew that he was happy to stand aside. And I just thought, I remember thinking at the time, the selflessness of that was just, terrific, and I just loved the accent as well. With accents, one of the first things that comes at you was Sean, and I just loved speaking to him ever since. He was probably my favourite Celt to speak to when I was at the Celtic View and the website, and so it came round when I was approached by a publisher, Backpage Press, who worked on like the Barcelona book by Graeme Hunter and a few other really good books, Football Manager book and the Alan Gilzean book. And they said they were looking to do something on Celtic, and they asked me if I would be interested, and they suggested something maybe a bit more up-to-date, you know, like a kind of more modern book. And I said, well, look, to be honest, I think the big untold Celtic story, and I said, I'm amazed no one's done it before now, is Sean Fallon. I said, I just can't believe that no one's ever done a book about on him, and I don't know whether it's because he's not interested or what the reasons are. I said, but I just, if you were doing a book in Celtic, Sean Fallon would be the one that I just think has to be done. Before then, I hadn't really thought. To be honest, I'd have written a book. I was working full time for FIFA by then, and I was fairly busy, and I hadn't really thought about doing a book. But as I say, the publishers kind of got me thinking, and I said they were really keen when I mentioned Sean, and I said, well, let me go away, and I'll find out if he's interested. And at that point, I spoke to his family, and I found out that sure enough, he had been approached by loads of people down the years. So it wasn't the fact there wasn't any interest, and actually, he just decided recently he was keen to do something. Alex Ferguson apparently had been at him at a dinner, and he said, you know, when are you going to do a book, Sean? You've got such a terrific story. And so it was Alex Ferguson that had finally convinced him.
I thought, Stephen, you were going to tell me that it was you convinced him that Alex Ferguson
No,
couldn't.
I'd love to say that was the case, but not at all. But at that point, I thought it wasn't going to be myself who was doing it. As I say, it was almost completely published, promised to another publishers. And they said, look, let's speak to this publishers, because I think that, you know, they had a fairly decent impression from me, and you know, I think Sean was quite happy, you know, with dealing with me, and they said, let's speak to his publishers and we'll see how it goes. But then it went very quiet, and I'd kind of given up completely, pretty much. And then all of a sudden I got a call from young Sean, from Sean's son, and he said, are you still interested? And I said, of course. And we just went from there. And so yeah, over the last year I've been going up and seeing Sean most weeks, and speaking to him, and speaking to his family, speaking to people he worked with, because we decided right from the start it couldn't be a strictly first person autobiography. Partly because Sean's memory was going a little bit, his memory was still very strong on certain areas, and you hopefully see that in the book. But you know, he was 90, and he was very conscious himself of the fact that his memory wasn't perfect in some areas, but also because he's genuinely one of the most modest, humble men you'll ever meet in your life, you'll ever meet. And he wouldn't have said the things about himself that other people say about him. And so you had to go and you had to speak to the Lou McCarries and the Billy McNeils and the Danny McGrains, and they would tell you, and Alex Ferguson's, and they would tell you that this guy did this for Celtic, this guy did this, he was fantastic at this, because Sean would never tell you himself. You know, so there was a kind of modesty aspect and there was a memory aspect that made it important to mix the two. So we're going to have it'll be a blend of third person and first person, and hopefully it'll do him justice. That's my real hope, that it'll be worthy of the man.
It's very sad that, you know, to live for an 80-year-old and have the career that Sean Fallon had, and then to finally get round to doing a book, or, you know, approve a book to be written about you, and not to live to see the fruits of that, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And at first, I mean, I was really sad about that, you know, that aspect of it. I thought I would, you know, I was gutted that he wasn't able to be around to see it. But do you know what? He wasn't doing it for himself. He always said, I'm doing this for the grandkids. You know, I mean, he's got 19 grandkids. He's got the 20th on the way. And I think that was it. As I say, he was always such a humble man, and he never, ever sought credit or a claim for all the things that he did. And so it wasn't a case of, I want this as a vanity project for me. It was all about the grandkids, you know. And also, he said, hopefully it will, you know, show young people the right kind of example. Because, I mean, he was such a professional, and such the standard he lived by, honestly. I mean, sometimes when you delve into someone a bit more deeply, you find things that maybe disappoint you a little bit, but everything new I learned about Sean just made me admire him all the more, and made me just like him all the more. He was honestly such a great man, and I mean, I'm really sorry he won't be able to see it, but I think the family feel that it's all the more important for them now, you know, and for the grandkids to see it. And if they're happy with it, that'll be all that matters to me.
I think the one of the main things that sort of when I heard about you writing the book and all this kind of stuff that made me so happy about it was, you know, everybody knows the Jock Stein story, and there's been hundreds of books written about Jock Stein, yeah. And you know, everywhere you turn at Celtic, Jock Stein's there in some shape or form. But just the role that Sean Fallon played to contribute to the success of that team is absolutely incredible.
No, you're absolutely right, and I think the way it happened with Jock Stein, with him dying fairly young, and with him never really having had time to sit down, I think he'd promised to do a book with McIlvany before he died, and it just never happened in the end. And so he's become this kind of mythical figure. And Sean, I mean, I've actually was looking back a lot at some of the Celtic View stuff I did with Sean, and I was as guilty as anyone of treating him like almost like a witness to history. You know, like he was there, and he played in the 7-1 game, and he was there for Lisbon, and he was beside Steen all the way. And so you think that's why his story will be so great, because he witnessed all these things. But actually, the more you go into it, he wasn't just a witness, he was a massive participant, you know, and he participated more than he would ever let on himself. That's the thing. And the pity is that Jock Stein isn't around to say, look, this guy did this for me, and this, you know, because I'm sure he would have, you know, I'm sure that he knew they were so close, and I'm sure he would have highlighted the contribution they had. Because I tell you, the one thing I've learned, and I've read a lot of the kind of Clough books and the Clough and Taylor things, the you know, everyone knows about Clough and Taylor, that partnership and all the things that Peter Taylor contributed there, and signing the players, you know, signing all the players of their great European Cup teams, and being that kind of buffer between Clough and the players, and taking the kind of hard edges off Clough, and, you know, just all that little kind of barrier.
Yes.
Sean Fallon was at least as important as Peter Taylor in that relationship. You know, that is in terms of signing the players, because he signed a great deal of the Lions and then all of the Quality Street kids. So he basically signed, what you know, the bulk of one European Cup winning team, and then another European Cup, another team that should have won the European Cup if it had been kept together by Celtic. Because, I mean, Billy McNeil says the Quality Street kids were even more talented than Lions.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, when you think about that, you know, and as well, he played exactly the same role behind the scenes, and calming the little disputes between the Steen and the players, because relations weren't always great there. So he just had such a massive role. And yet, as I say, the statues of Peter Taylor, you know, and everyone knows about Peter Taylor, but beyond, you know, until recently, I think, Sean, until he died, I don't think he was given nearly the credit he was deserved.
I mean, even when you mentioned the name Sean Fallon, most people will tell you, oh yeah, he was the manager when Big Jock was hurt, yeah, and we didn't win anything. But when you look at sort of the contributions, you say when he went and signed the Davy Hayes and guys like that, incredible that this went on day and daily at Celtic when we were doing 9 in a row, when we won the European Cup, and still we've got Jock Stein there and a statue outside Celtic Park, and yet, you know, Sean's not there.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying there should be a statue. I mean, and Sean, the one thing that I was very keen with this book, and Sean was equally keen, was that you shouldn't build up Sean Fallon by knocking down Jock Stein, because Sean was always the first to say that Jock Stein was the right man for Celtic and a magnificent manager. He says he was one of the greatest ever. And I'm not saying that Sean Fallon could have done what Jock Stein did. He couldn't have, and Sean was the first to tell you that. But that's not to say it's the same with Peter Taylor couldn't have done what Brian Clough did, you know, but he still played a massive role in making Clough successful. Sean Fallon played a massive role in making Jock Stein successful, and we should recognise that, and it shouldn't be that Jock Stein was this one-man miracle worker, you know, because it's not the case. You know, he did have great people around him, and as I say, I'm sure he would have been the first to acknowledge that. And if you look at the Lions quotes over the last few weeks after Sean passed away, they're all the first to point that out, and the guys that worked with him. And I think that's the point I was looking, you know, hoping to get across, that, you know, he wasn't just a witness to history, you know, he was such an active participant. And but as I say, he would never have pointed that out himself, you know, and he was such a Celtic man as well. It was never about Sean Fallon, it was never about his own ego. So when it came to him having to stand aside for Jock Stein in 65, he was more than happy to do it. But you're right about the in terms of people remembering them for that single season in 75-76 when Jock Steen had the car crash and he was in charge and Celtic won nothing, because that is, and that's partly, I think, the reason why is not his legacy has been kind of tarnished a little bit, because people remember him for that and they think, well, that shows who was the real genius there. You know, that shows that Sean really wasn't. The fact is, yeah. we'd lost the last season, the 74-75 season, Celtic had absolutely collapsed. It was the worst possible season he could have taken over because, as I say, we'd collapsed the second half of the season before. The pre-season, they'd lost Billy McNeil, Jinky, and it's just a nightmare run of injuries that season. They signed Johnny Doyle, Sean, and then Johnny Doyle got injured almost immediately. He just had an absolute nightmare time of it, and it was the worst possible season to take over. I mean, Celtic were really on the slide by then. But he wouldn't be the guy to come out and make excuses for it. You know, he wouldn't be the guy to come out and say, well, this is the reason why these things happened. And some of the things will get explained in the book. Mm-hmm. And as well, I mean, I think he's tarnished a little bit with the early 60s, you know, the record there. But it was such, Celtic was so dysfunctional then. We had a manager who wasn't really a manager in Jimmy McGrory, who was really just a figurehead. You'd a chairman who was really just running things as a manager, and Sean was like caught in between the two of them, and it was a really, really difficult and a fairly unhappy time for him. He was such a Celtic man that he stuck around, but he much preferred it when he had a set, defined role under Steen, and they worked so brilliantly together, you know. So I think you're absolutely right. I think that the 75-76 season of him being the manager and being in the spotlight for that one season and things not working out well has tended to see people writing them off. I mean, I remember reading on one fans forum something like, there was a thing about Sean, and one of the fans wrote in, Sean was a good guy, good Celtic man, but if it wasn't for him taking over, Celtic would have done 10 in a row. I mean, it's just, the fact is, we'd lost 10 in a row the season before when Jock Steen was still there.
Yeah.
But these are the kind of myths that kind of build, you know. Mm-hmm. But anyway, as I say, you can get frustrated about these things when you delve more deeply into it and you find. But Sean, the fact that Sean isn't seen as the absolute giant he was is largely due to the fact that Sean was so humble, and hopefully through other people, through the quotes we've got from the players that worked with him, and through some of my own research, we can put that right.
So, Stephen, also when you talk about Bob Kelly there, Bob mm-hmm. Kelly, this is probably terrible. You know, we're talking about a book about another man, and we know the story so far. You know, it's like talking about the Titanic. Anyway, Bob Kelly wanted Sean to be manager and Steen to be his assistant at the beginning. Isn't that right? Or is that
that's
just
right.
a rumour?
No, that's definitely right. I mean, well, I mean, to be honest, we're taking that more from Steen's side. It wasn't like this was a plan cooked up between Sean and Bob Kelly or anything. It was, but there's no doubt that Sean was a favoured son of Bob Kelly's. To be honest, I mean, he wasn't alone in that. I mean, Steen himself was a real, favoured son of Bob Kelly's, and they'd made Sean and Jock Steen part of the backroom staff, you know, and created a job for Jock Steen when he retired. Mm-hmm. So I think I know he's a very divisive figure, Bob Kelly, but he did some quite good things at that time. It was unfortunate that Jock Steen left to go to Dunfermline, but maybe he needed to do that to kind of come back and have the kind of wherewithal to go to Bob Kelly and say, look, I'm picking the team and stay out of it because I've proved already at Dunfermline and Hibs that I deserve that respect of being allowed to pick the team. Mm-hmm. Whereas Sean, if had he made Sean manager, it would have been more difficult for Sean to do that. I think he would have tried to pick the team himself, but I think Jock Steen was in a much stronger position, having gone and proved himself elsewhere. But no, there's no doubt that was Bob Kelly's idea, was that Sean and would be the manager, and that hopefully Jock would come in and work beside him. I think the joint manager thing was definitely mooted. But as I say, it wasn't like that was ever discussed with Sean. I mean, even though there was all this talk about Sean being lined up for the job, he said that Bob Kelly never mentioned a thing to him. He said it was always kind of talked about behind the scenes, but he said at no point did Bob Kelly ever say, this is your job, you know, this is the job's lined up for you, basically. So it was all misunderstood, one of these things. It was one of these things that was just assumed, and everyone was talking about it behind the scenes, but it was never explicitly stated to Sean. So, but Sean knew himself, and I think he made it clear that when the joint manager thing was mooted, that that this won't work, and basically that he was more than happy to work with Jock Steen as his number two.
Was Sean and Jock Steen big pals before they started up this management duo, though?
They were, yeah, absolutely. I mean, one thing that I hadn't really appreciated about Sean's story that was quite so important was him becoming captain. He was made captain just under a year after Jock Steen arrived, and you'll probably know that when Jock Steen arrived, there was the Celtic squad and the Celtic fans were very sceptical about him. You know, he was this old, this kind of veteran centre-half arriving for the reserves from Linnethley, you know, and he had no pedigree. I mean, he was Albion Rovers, and no one thought anything of him, and there was a lot of, you know, Charlie Tully and a few others were really quite critical of the signing. Mm-hmm. And he gradually worked his way in the team, but he wasn't a regular, and Sean became captain in 53, I think it was, and he then, in fact, he was 52, I think, and then he, one of his first games, he broke his arm. But before then, he'd been asked to, one of your jobs in those days when you were made captain was to name your deputy. And everyone thought Bobby Evans was Scotland international at the time, very influential player, been there for years. Roberto Peacock was Sean's best pal. He was his best pal from when he arrived at Celtic. But he saw something in Steen that the others didn't seem to see at that point, and he just saw that this guy knew his football, was a real strong personality, that he liked the way he'd accepted the criticism and just got on with his job, trained well, and he thought, no, this guy's got something about him. So he made Steen his vice-captain, much to everyone's shock. And then, sure enough, you know, as I say, he breaks his arm a couple of weeks later, and Steen becomes captain from being a kind of, you know, a centre-half who was struggling to get in the team. He's in the Celtic captain, and he was then the Celtic captain for the Coronation Cup. Mm-hmm. And from then they went touring round with the Coronation Cup with Bob Kelly, Steen and Bob Kelly, and that was when they became very close, because they were both, you know, from kind of mining stock and Lanarkshire guys. And so that Steen was always grateful for that. He was always very, very grateful to Sean for the fact that he had boosted him at Celtic beyond, you know, what anyone could have expected. And they were great pals. There was always a kind of Ferraris gang. They always used to go to Ferraris on the restaurant, and they would all sit at lunchtime. It'd be him and Bertie Peacock and Jock, and I think Bobby Evans would join them sometimes. And they were the guys that would talk football. They would really go into the game in detail. And, you know, they went down to watch games down in England, and Bob Kelly paid for them to go down to see Hungary at Wembley, that kind of famous game. And they went out to see Wolves in European games and things as well. So they were very much students of the game. And I think as well, they stayed close. Not, they obviously didn't see each other as much, but when Jock Steen left to go to the Infirmary, they were still friendly. And so when they came back, I think Jock Steen was more worried that Sean would be put out because, you know, he had been very much lined up for the job. But as I say, Sean being the kind of man he is, I think there's a certain kind of character. You need a certain kind of character to be an assistant manager, because it's not all about you. You know, he's not the, you know, I think David Hay was talking about it, and he was saying that he always admired that about Sean, that he was happy to do all these things for Celtic, to sign all these players, but not expect any of the credit for it. And he said you have to be a certain kind of character to be an assistant manager, and David Hay was saying, I don't think I actually could be a very good assistant, he said. And he said, I always admired Sean for the fact he had the kind of personality that would allow him to do that. So, no, they were great pals, and they used to room together on European trips and everything, you know, once they came back, and the families were very close. Sean used to always take out George Steen, Jock's son, for games of golf, and he was called his golf father. And they were known as, I think, all the Fallon children called Jock Steen Uncle Jock. And they used to go out to the sea, you know, out to Largs and things together. And they were really genuinely great pals.
Going back to the book itself, Stephen, is the book finished right now? Are we waiting for publication dates, or where are we with the book itself?
The book itself is not finished as yet. It's well on the way. And we're looking, that plan was really to put it out. We were taking our time with Sean himself and with getting basically, you know, conscious that I wanted to make sure I did exactly everything, you know, go into everything in as much detail as I possibly could, and not push on too hard because, you know, of his age. And hopefully, I didn't want to make it too much of a slog for him. I wanted him to enjoy it, to kind of enjoy going down memory lane, and to bring up, you know, photos when I went up to see him. And I think I like to think he did enjoy it. And so, as I say, we've been taking our time over it, and you would hope that Sean was keeping well enough that he would have been around to see it, but obviously that's not happened. So you're probably looking, our plan was to get out around his birthday, which is in late July. So I know it's quite far off, and people may be a bit disappointed by that, but hopefully by taking our time and doing it right and speaking to as many people as we can, and you know, I'm not been immersing myself in every Celtic book ever written, you know, and hopefully that pays off in the end.
And how long have you been writing the book as of now in February?
Well, I've been writing it, actually, the process of writing, I mean, as I say, the process of researching and interviewing took a long time. Mm-hmm. So it's only been the last month or so that I've really got down to actually writing it. You know, I've been preparing, you know, so many notes you wouldn't believe, and, you know, transcribing a million interviews, but the process of writing's only really started kicking off over the last month, so it's evolved a little bit already. Initially, we'd planned to have it kind of first-person chapter followed by a third-person chapter, you know, but we thought maybe better to intersperse it too and to have it basically in a third-person style with long chunks of Sean's quotes in there, mm-hmm. and quotes from other people as well, but we don't want to lose the fact that it's Sean's story, and to have as much of his personality and his story in there. So we've got good people working on it anyway. I mean, the guys at the publishers are terrific. I mean, they really want to put out, you know, quality books. They're not just looking to put out fodder. I mean, and they, we've made that clear from the start. I mean, they're basically writers who've come to this from a position of kind of not been very impressed with publishers they've worked with in the past. And I'm also working, Hugh McDonald's working with us as well. He's going to help edit it, Hugh McDonald at the Herald. And he's a very good guy and a good editor, good writer. So we should have good people around about it. So I'm hoping it will be a success.
Coming up to the end, did you see Sean's health deteriorating? And were you thinking, oh no, this doesn't look good at the minute?
Well, I mean, it was not spectacular. It wasn't a significant thing. It was a real shock when he died, because he had been, the night before, he'd been doing an interview with RTE for a documentary, which is coming up a week tomorrow, so on the 22nd. A week on Friday, apologies. And so that's one to look out for. But he was in great form. He was in absolutely great form, and he was still keeping well. He smoked like a chimney, I mean, you know, and he was 90 years old, so you know that, you know, there's always a risk, but he was really keeping well, and he was, like I say, he was in great form. There was a steady decline over the years, as you'd expect, but nothing marked, you know, and nothing to make us think that was something like that was going to happen. But the good thing was all his family were around him at the end, you know, that all his family got around to see him. It was a sudden thing, but all his, you know, that he's got mostly all of his family are in Glasgow. He's obviously got sisters and things in, over in Sligo, but all the Scottish family, the ones that are out, he's got a daughter out in Seamill and a daughter in Edinburgh and grandchildren there, and they all got through to see him. So that was the important thing, and you know, I think the family have taken a lot of comfort from the way he's been, just the way Celtic have been, the way everyone's been in the time since his death, and again, hopefully the documentary will be a nice tribute to him, and hopefully the book will be worthy of him. So, but yeah, it was a real shock. It was a real shock when it came about, despite the fact he was 90 years old. But one thing I'm really delighted about, and all the family were delighted about, was that he got that moment in the sun, the flag day, before the end, you know, because he was one of these, you know, as I say, someone who'd been kind of in the shadow of Jock Stein, in the shadow of the Tullys and the guys, the real stars when he played, and for him to get that moment of the fans singing happy birthday to him and being out there centre stage, you know, that was special. And it was more than even for Sean, again for the grandkids, because the grandkids have grown up in an era where, unless you're really into Celtic history, maybe you don't know about Sean Fallon, you know, like maybe that some of the guys in their class won't know who Sean Fallon is, whereas, you know, you go along to that game and Sean was absolutely mobbed, and mm-hmm. you know, you've got one of his granddaughters is saying to her mum, she's like, Papa's like Justin Bieber. So, you know, he was getting mobbed by so many fans, so that's a comparison you never expected to hear, but it was brilliant for them, and Celtic, you know, brought them all in, brought all the family in, and Neil Lennon brought them all, the entire family in. I think he said to Sean, you know, bring the family in after the game to my office. And the Celtic manager's office is really tiny. Right. And Sean troops in with his 19 grandkids and all his kids. Like, Neil Lennon expected that, but he was brilliant with them, and as I say, it was a real, for the whole family, it was just a brilliant day. And I think that to have had that, you know, that day where they were able to really celebrate and have the fans singing happy birthday to Sean was really special.
And in 2002, he was actually awarded the Freedom of Sligo as well.
That's right, yeah, that was around his, they had a big 80th celebration over there for him, and that was a terrific weekend. Again, Neil Lennon was actually Celtic's player representative over there, and Alex Ferguson flew over from it. Again, he kind of, I think he was meant to be away with pre-season with Man United, and he cancelled his plans and went over to join Sean, and there was a big, and there was, probably people don't know, but Sean's father was actually a big, really important man in Sligo. He was a mayor for a long time, and he was a massive figure in Sligo Rovers, and they dedicated a bridge, opened a bridge, and they called it the John Fallon Footbridge, and so that was opened around that time as well. And so it was just I think it was just a tremendous time, that, you know, around 2002, and it was the whole weekend, as I say, lots of the Lions went over. Alex Ferguson was there, Neil Lennon, and that he was such a proud Sligo man. I mean, it's obviously, you know yourself, he never lost his accent, and he was here since 1950, and he loved it. He went every, last year was the only year in his entire time here that he didn't make it back there. And that was just because of his health, because he was getting a little bit more frail and the journey was going to be more difficult for him. So he was, he just loved Sligo. I mean, every time he'd speak about him, you know, about the place, his eyes would just light up. And I mean, I was going over there to, as part of the research for the book, and I told him I was staying in Ross's Point, you know, he was just delighted, he just loved Ross's Point, and then, you know, he came back and he was asking me questions, and what do I think of this, and he was really, I loved Sligo myself, thought it was just a great place, and he was really delighted that I loved it, you know, that way. So he was such a proud Sligo man, and he's so loved over there, he really is. And I think, again, the danger is always that through the generations, people get forgotten, but there's people that are really keeping him alive over there, and it's just great to see.
Every time I go to Sligo, it rains. Yeah. There you go. There's an uninteresting point about Sligo. I've been to Sligo three times, and three times it has rained out of the heavens.
Well, there you go. I think I got that sunshine, actually. And I was there for the Spartak Moscow away game as well. So it was. I was put up by a guy called Sean Cunningham, who started the Sean Fallon Celtic Supporters Club. And he was... I was watching the game in his pub when we beat Spartak, so as well, that was, I've got fond memories of Sligo for almost for that alone, but back then, that was great. It was getting go through the old Sligo Champion newspapers, and I met one of his sisters, and it was just great. And I met one of his teammates, bizarrely enough, who kind of sought me out. I found one of the guys who'd played with him in, like, you know, early 1940s, which was really unexpected, because one of the problems with Sean, you know, doing a book about a guy who's 90 is that when you go back to their earlier life and you're trying to find people to talk to, most of them are dead, you know, and that was the problem. It was trying to find people who played with him, because even like the team, you know, like so the 7-1 team and everything, like, you know, Bobby Collins, I think, is still going, but he's really bad with Alzheimer's, I think, and so we really couldn't speak to him, and you were struggling. You know, Bertie Olds played with him for a little bit of time as well, and he had some nice memories to share, and Billy McNeil a little bit as well. But beyond that, and we got Frank O'Farrell, who'd played with him for the Republic of Ireland. So to have this guy walking off the street and say, you know, I played with Sean when he was, you know, a young man, was a real surprise, and it was a nice little bonus.
Very good, very good. So, Stephen, we've talked a lot about Sean Fallon, and you know, you're saying about the documentary coming up on RTE, the book coming out, and all this year kind of stuff. I want to talk a wee bit about you and your career as well. FIFA.com, you're the editor of FIFA.com.
Well, that's a sweet bit more grand than it probably is in reality. I mean, there's a group of editors. I mean, really, they call us editors rather than the porters. There's six channels on the FIFA website, and there's English, Spanish, German, Arabic and Portuguese, and I think I'm missing one out there, French, and we're part of the English team, and there's guys based there in England, there's one living in Brazil, and yeah, so I'm one of the editorial team there, and it's mainly editorial work, and it's a lot of time what happens is it's you get people writing, say we've got correspondents in Asia and in Africa who write in English, but it's not their first language, so they'll send over to us, and we'll bash it together and hopefully make it into something fairly readable. And yeah, I did a fair bit of writing as well, but I was saying to you before, maybe not as much about Celtic as I would like, so it's been lovely to get back into doing something Celtic related by doing the book and Sean, so that's been great. But it's a terrific job, don't get me wrong, I love it. I mean, it's, you know, you get away to the World Cups and the various FIFA tournaments, and it was, you know, like the kind of junior tournaments and futsal and these kind of things, and it's very interesting and very cosmopolitan, and you meet lots of interesting people, and I suppose it broadens your horizons a little bit, which is I've loved it. The Celtic, years at Celtic were absolutely brilliant, and I mean, I was fortunate to be there under the kind of Martin O'Neill era, which was, you know, just a perfect time to be there. Working people like Gregor Kyle, you know, so...
Never heard of him.
You can't have everything.
You had about 10 questions there lined up, and then you kept telling me more interesting facts. Let's rewind a wee bit, first of all. You're the person responsible for the classic line from a footballer's, it was lost in translation then.
Yeah, exactly.
So I know who to play, that's brilliant. And then, wait a minute, so then after that, World Cups?
That
must be tough, eh?
I mean, this is where I tell you, it's really, really, it is genuinely hard work, and you get your little violin out, that was my first tournament. They took me on basically for the 2006 World Cup, and it was in a short-term contract, and it was a case of, you know, take the risk, and if they like you, you know, the chances are you'll have a job at the end of it. Unfortunately, they, for some reason, they did like me, so they kept me on, and it's contract to contract, but my contract's keep on being renewed so far, so fingers crossed.
So your first audition was the World Cup?
First one was the World Cup.
Bloody
in Germany.
Hell.
I know, right in there, so it was great. It really was terrific, and I mean, we're in Berlin, and Berlin's a brilliant city, so I'm really lucky. I mean, you know, it's funny, though, because you go from... My profile is probably much lower since I... And that's fine with me. I mean, I have no desire to be kind of high profile in any way, so, but it's when I used to work at Celtic, you know, you had people coming up, what's happening with the transfers, what's happening with this, and I think no one knows what I'm doing half the time these days, which is absolutely fine. But I remember I was, you know, used to play fives like the guys, and when I got the FIFA job, you know, they said, what's happening with Celtic? I said, I actually left Celtic now, I'm working for FIFA. And like, one of the guys was like, I'm really sorry, mate, you know, like, you know, I've kind of taken a step down the world, It does show you how much people really just love Celtic, and it's right the way that they see it that way, but it was quite funny. You know, you think you're quite proud of yourself, you've got a job at FIFA, and he was consoling me.
I know, that's fantastic. Yeah, I know, I had to give up Falkirk to go to Berlin for the World Cup. Must really suck to be you, Stephen, eh? But what's funny is, you did actually work for the Celtic View right up until you joined this wee cushy number that you have right now in FIFA.com. You were 7 years at the Celtic View, yeah?
That's right, yeah. I was there from the Barnsdale Goose season. It was my first season there, kind of full time. Before that, the reason I kind of got into it really was I used to do youth games when I was at uni. I used to do kind of youth games for nothing, just for experience. And that's sort of any kind of aspiring journalist out there, that's what I would further recommend doing is just do jobs for nothing and try and get and impress people by what you're doing, and then hopefully, you know, you get in on the basis of that, because that was what happened. Basically, I did these games, went about to under-18 games and across the country, and just sent in my reports and got them published, and then someone left the Celtic View, and they said, look, would you fancy coming in and doing a bit of full-time work for a while? And that was all kicked on from there. So, no, it was interesting times. I mean, obviously, the first season was difficult, to say the least, although when you're going in, I mean, I was a season ticket holder, and you're going in and you just... Bowled over, you know. You just, I loved it even then, even though that was, you know, the Super Cali days and everything, and it's just fantastic. I mean, one of my first jobs at the View was to, and I was still at uni at this point, was to go away to the winter break. One of the first winter breaks was in Portugal, and it was just after Rafael had arrived. Rafael, good old Rafael.
Yes.
And so, you know, that was it. You were just straight into this amazing world, you know, of guys, you know, in the hotel with Henry Larson and Mark Viduka and all these guys, and you've just couple of weeks before you've been in the stand cheering on. It's just incredible, you know. So it was a brilliant time, and things got better and better under Martin O'Neill, obviously. So it was a brilliant time to be there.
Will you pick my lottery numbers for Saturday night?
No, I know. My pals hate me. Honestly, my pals absolutely despise me because I've, you know, he's gone from one brilliant job to another, so you can't blame him.
You're bloody hilarious. Now you're saying about poor university students going to do stuff for free. There's plenty to do your job for free if they got those perks.
I know. No, but I mean, that's it. I think people... You know, people sometimes say, how did you get into that? You know, what degree did you do and everything? And I say, like, the degree really, to be honest, had nothing to do with it. Because, you know, I think it's really a case of just, if you do, and the good thing is that these days, I think, because of, you know, blogging and things, there's probably more opportunities for people to have their things seen. But I know that as well, when we're taking on people at FIFA, which doesn't happen very often, but when we are, it's really a case of you want to see what they can do. You know, we do tests with them and we give them writing assignments and editing assignments rather than, you know, the CV is great, you obviously look at the CV, but the most important thing is can you do the job, and that's, you know, what you can look for more than anything.
All right, now I can't hold my tongue on this one. This is going to be a cracker. All right, so you say you give the wee writing assignments and all that there kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Have they write like they're writing for the Celtic View?
Well, I mean...
And you know what I mean by that?
No comment on that one. No, I mean, to be honest, I was not in any way involved with when they were taking on people at the View, you know, I mean, but it was, just in terms of the FIFA side of things, as I say, they set writing assignments for people, and it's mainly just to make sure they're going to write in English rather than American English. that's a pet hate, so, yeah, but no, I've been very lucky, don't get me wrong, and I mean, again, as well, the book as well, hugely, so lucky, I mean, such an honour to be doing this, you know, I mean, it's because, as I say, so many people would have loved to have done this story and shown, so many people have asked them down the years, and to be given the chance to do it is just a massive honour, and I know that, you know, people maybe were thinking at this stage, you know, that you get the guys out there, the David Potters of the world, and, mm-hmm. You know, Arch McPherson's have done brilliant Celtic books, and, you know, I'm a jammy so-and-so to have got it, but hopefully I justify the family's faith in me, you know, and hopefully and the publisher's faith, but I do appreciate that, you know, it's been important for me to completely, because obviously I didn't live through those days, you know, so I've tried to immerse myself as much in the books and interviews of people who were there and try to, you know, go beyond the knowledge I think most Celtic fans have at that time, and you have from reading the books and watching the DVDs and the videos, and hopefully that comes across in the book. But I mean, the Sean story is such a fantastic story anyway that anyone writing it, you can only mess it up. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? If I mess it up,
no pressure then.
Exactly. But you know, because it's just it's a fantastic story, and he was great. I mean, like I say, although his memory wasn't what it was, and he was very conscious of that. He was always apologising, say, I'm sorry, son, you know, and always heading that big brown ball, which from my memory in, but he was actually brilliant, you know, and I mean, I was totting up all the quotes I had from him before I started the kind of writing process of it all, and 100,000 words worth of quotes, you know, from a 90-year-old man. Uh-huh. So, you know, he'd done absolutely brilliantly, the whole thing was just a pleasure, you know, you know, speaking to me, you can imagine yourself, you know, occasionally...
I can only imagine.
You know, it's just, you know, it was just honestly such a pleasure, such an honour, such a privilege to go up and sit in a guy like his company every week.
Sure.
And, you know, and the guys, I'm sure the guys at The View right now and Gregor and people who've worked there before will tell you that people always think, you know, when you work there, they say, oh, it must be brilliant, you know, going on down to speak to the players and, you know, speaking to the Larsons and these kind of guys. And that's nice, don't get me wrong, when everything comes away and when they turn up and they will actually speak to you, it's great. But the best part I always found of the job was dealing with the guys like Sean Fallon, Billy McNeil, Betty Hall, because the passion they've got for it and it just comes through in everything. And, you know, the stories you've got to tell, and you'd always come off the phone or from going away to meet them just buzzing because, you know, you just reaffirmed everything that made you love Celtic in the first place, speaking to these guys, you know.
Yeah.
And so that was what it was like going up to see Sean every week.
I couldn't agree more. When we do some of the interviews with some of the ex-players on Lost Boys, you know, you could just listen to them all day long.
The guys
over at the convention in America, you know, the Bertie Alls and guys like that, I mean, my God, you could just listen for hours and hours and hours. And even though they've told these stories 1,000 times, they're happy to do it with you too, you know?
Ah, absolutely. I mean, they just... and their love for the club is so genuine. You know, that's what comes across. And the fact is, when you see... I remember seeing after Flag Day, Bertie Ogg was outside, you know, signing autographs and taking pictures with the fans, and he just loved it. He was just in his element, you know, that way. And they were all, they're all like that. They just, you know, not, they love the fans. They love, and that was the thing about Sean as well. I was expecting, because it was, you know, one thing, you know, that he was treated badly by Celtic in the end, as Jock Stein was. He really was treated badly. But there wasn't an ounce of bitterness in him. He just loved Celtic. He couldn't have spoke highly enough about the club. And he just, there was, he honestly, I like to say, it was so uplifting to speak to him, because you speak to some ex-players from all sorts of clubs and they'll have little gripes here and there and be bitter about this or bitter about that. He did not have a bitter bone in his body, Sean Fallon, and every time you spoke to him, and even when you wanted, it was important to speak to him about these times and the time where he was sacked, and you know, and it was difficult again. He'd again turn it around to other people and he would say, "Hi, well, it was poor, but you know, the way they treated Jock was even worse." And you know, and then he'd say, and the one thing he always said was, it was sad for Celtic sacked him because it broke the club's links with Sligo at that point, and he always felt, because of brother Wilfred, and he was such a keen student of the club's history, that he hated that to happen, you know, because he was, I mean, the background, I don't want to give away kind of too much, but I think most of the background's known about Sean, that, you know, his sister was saved by the son of Jimmy McMenemy from drowning. But also his father had come to Glasgow after the war. He was fighting the war, and he'd come here, and he'd started supporting Celtic, and he'd come back to Sligo, absolutely buzzing about this club, found about a Sligo man, and was telling Sean all these stories. And so right from the start, there was this kind of love affair, and he just loved Celtic. I've never seen them play. He grew up just loving Celtic, and it was really kind of a romantic story. He was sent over by this Joe McMenemy, son of Jimmy McMenemy. He was sent over the Willie Mailey book, and he read this cover to cover time and time again, and so he knew all about brother Wilfred, and he came over, and he used to write a column for one of the newspapers, and he'd write about Celtic history in this column, and honestly, you could not meet a man who loved Celtic more. And I think that's well known about Sean. I mean, I'm quite keen in the book to go past that, because in every book you read about, you know, and they'll say about Sean what a great Celt he was and everything, and he was. I mean, he just loved Celtic so much, but he also wasn't just a great, you know, he contributed so much to the club, you know, and he gave Celtic, you know, at least as much as Celtic gave him.
So, Stephen, this is your first book. I know you've been writing for a long, long time. Was Sean the reason why you decided to actually write a book, and how daunting is that?
Yeah, I mean, the short answer to that is yes, it was because of Sean, because, as I said, I was approached to do a book, and I was lukewarm about it. You know, I wasn't entirely convinced about doing something unless there was a real story there, and as I say, I said to them straight away, I said, for me, that if you're looking to do a book in Celtic, Sean Fallon, you know, I just think he's the absolute untold Celtic story. I mean, he was, and so it was because of him that did it, and in terms of it being daunting, absolutely, because, as I say, he's such a beloved figure, and so many people, everyone he's come into contact with, just loves him, you know, he's such a great figure, and I'm so conscious of the responsibility of doing him justice, and it does at times it weighs heavily, you know, that way, but you want it to be that way because you don't want to take it, and I don't want it to be just another Celtic book. I want it to be special, I want it to be worthy of Sean Fallon, and I hope it will be, and I hope that's why, as I say, it's taken a bit of time, and there's a few reasons for that, but the main reason is hopefully that we get it right, and we don't cut any corners, and if that happens and people are happy with it, then I think hopefully, you know, it will have been worth taking that time and worth the wait.
When you think about the number of years that he was involved with Celtic, it covers generations, you know, just the whole story, you know, of everything that happened with the 9 in a row and the European Cup and the Steen years. And then you're talking there about when he was playing, and he played in some of the biggest games in Celtic's history as well. You know, it's all there, and that's what's exciting about it. And the very fact that there hasn't been a book by Sean Fallon before.
No, that's it. I mean, you're absolutely right. You look at his contribution over so many years, you know, over such a long because you think about it, he joined in 1950, you know, then, you know, so he was part of the team. He came back and he was a real driving force in the team that won the first double in four decades, and then he was in the 7-1 team, went on to be part of the coaching staff, you know, Jock Steen's right-hand man through the greatest years in the club's history. And then still at the end, you know, when he was demoted and he was chief scout, he was still signing Paddy Bonner, still signing Paul McStay. So you're looking at the greatest player. Still, Paul McStay was still our best player in the mid-90s.
Mm-hmm.
So from 1950 to the mid-90s, you're talking about this guy who's had this massive influence over that whole period. So, as I say, the span of influence is massive, and there's very few people that can match that. And yet, I was one of the ones guilty of it. He can be treated almost as a witness, just as a witness to history, rather than someone that did so much as well. So,
yeah.
Hopefully, these things will all be put right in the book. And if people are wanting to kind of keep up to date with things getting, you know, when it's getting released and nearer the time, we've got a Twitter site and a Facebook site, Sean Fallon Celt on both. And we've been putting up pictures and little bits of information, you know, even when things like the documentary is getting released.
Mm-hmm.
And as I say, we've been getting nice pictures from the family over in Sligo and various things as well that we've been publishing up there, and people seem to quite like them. So people are more welcome to follow us and that and send us messages. And, you know, we've got an email address. They can always get in touch. And if there are any specific questions that they want to ask or anything they want to contribute, I mean, right at the start, you know, we were asking for fan stories and Sean, and there were some crackers that came in, and he loved been asked about them as well, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There were some really nice stories, so that's all been great, and you know, hopefully it'll be a kind of, you know, a project everyone will feel involved in as well, because it's, you know, he loved the fans as much as he loved Celtic, and he was very keen that they enjoyed the story as much as anyone else. As I say, there'll be details on the book as it comes, and there'll be details on the documentary that's coming up next Friday in RTE, and you'll just see various little pictures and things now and again we'll just stick up there, and, you know, little video clips and things like that, and hopefully things will just keep, you know, Sean's memory alive for people, and just things that people will enjoy looking at.
Just wonderful, absolutely wonderful. Stephen, absolute pleasure to talk to you as well.
Likewise, sir.
The best of luck with us, because this is something that I think most Celtic fans would be looking forward to once they hear about the book coming out and stuff. A well worthy story as well, and it's going to be great. And good luck to you and everything that comes with it.
Thanks very much.
So there you are, lads and lasses. That's us for another week. That was absolutely terrific. I could have talked to Stephen all night. I mean, even after we finished recording, we yarned for another 35, 40 minutes afterwards. You know, and he's telling me about how welcome he was by not only Sean Fallon, but the Fallon family, whenever he was doing the research for the book. Absolutely brilliant. It would break your heart, so it would. And we're going to catch up with Stephen again before the launch of the book, which will probably be sometime during the summer. Remember, on Friday the 22nd, on RTE, there is a documentary about Sean, and Stephen recommends it to everybody. He says it's absolutely fantastic. You know, Stephen's just one of those guys you get yarn to for hours and hours and hours. Just terrific. And such a humble guy. And he was so impressed. He couldn't speak highly enough about the Fallon family and how good they were to him and how welcome they made him. Anyway, that'll be one to look forward to in the future. We will have a podcast next week. I have a few wee things in the pipeline, although I dare say Jamie and Jerry will be banging on the door, and we may do a three amigos. So there's plenty of options, but it's good to see that we've got 5-6 weeks of interviews already lined up, and they'll be all there for you very soon on the HailHail Media channel. So remember now that you need to change your subscription to HailHail Media instead of the Lost Boys feed on iTunes. And I'd appreciate it if you sort of spread that news around, because probably some people are missing some of these podcasts. And after tonight's and Gregor's and some of the recent ones we've had have been absolutely superb. You know, just good listening and a wee bit different. So there you are. If you want to contact us, you can email us on lostboys@gmail.com. You can contact me on Twitter @ChrisLostBoy, or you can go straight to the Lost Boys on Twitter @TheLostBoys. Also, the Facebook page is there as well, of course. So there you are. That's your weekly dose of Lost Boys. And talk to you all next week. My name's Chris McGuigan, playing as usual, charting the boys and the song of Lonesome Boatman. Cheers.